Okay, good morning everybody, or good afternoon, or even perhaps good evening. I'm Ben Goldstein and my co-author Ceri Jones is here. We're both in sunny Spain, at different ends of it. We're very pleased to introduce this first session of Cambridge Live 2022. Well, sorry, maybe second session, but we're right at the beginning. So I hope that you enjoy it. We're going to be talking about keeping it personal, highlighting the personal touch in digital spaces. Okay, so this is the topic. And I think to begin with, we'd like to start by talking about what we mean by personal. So you may have heard, well, the term personalization in English language teaching is obviously a very familiar one to most of you. But recently it has been, let's say, been appropriated by education technology. And we'd just like to clarify from the start that we're not really talking about personalization or personalized learning in the way that EdTech talks about it. In other words, a kind of euphemism for adaptive learning. Here, we're talking about the personal. We're talking about the human touch, human personal connections in the classroom. And I think this quotation sums it up, because machines can't personalize education, only people can. And although that may seem a very obvious point to make, with so many of us teaching online since the pandemic, it is easy sometimes to forget that and you let technology do all the work. So this talk in reality is looking at, it's looking backwards, it's also looking forwards to our current, you know, to our situation now at the moment. We'll look at teacher testimonies from the pandemic, and how teachers coped with that situation. And we feel that's a really good way to begin, because clearly that's a personal comments that they're making, personal testimonies, which will be very valuable for this talk. Then we'll be looking at physical context. We'll be looking at the personal and the physical, and how, although it may seem contradictory, how it's actually possible to physicalize the digital space, get students moving, doing things physically, bringing in objects and so on, to again personalize that space. That's the sort of main part of the talk in reality. Then we'll be looking at Evolve Digital, which is a product that we have, Ceri and I have been involved in writing, and how we embrace the personal touch in those materials. And in particular, part four looks at real students and expert speakers. These are real role models for our learners, and these people are integrated within the methodology of Evolve Digital. And then we'll make some conclusions. So first of all, before, you know, without further ado, let's then look at these teacher testimonies. We're going to begin listening and also reading some quotations concerning what teachers experience during the pandemic and the implications for them now. And perhaps many of you now are teaching in a kind of hybrid environment, both online and face-to-face. But I think these testimonies will be very relevant, even if regardless of the format in which you're working. And again, this quotation I guess says it all. The main key element in effective and successful distance or online, if you prefer that term, is you, the teacher. And again, I think this is easy to forget. And this is something that you'll see is a message that runs through our whole talk today. The importance of you and your methodology and your personal connection with your learners. That, as I said, can sometimes get overlooked when there's so much technology, when technology seems to be controlling things. So let's begin with two questions. And I'm going to ask you now in the chat. Now I can't see the chat and Ceri can't see the chat either, but we have two questions, two big questions we'd like to ask you. And I believe I have an assistant, Yuri, who will be able to, well, give us a general impression of your responses. So there's just two questions. What have we learned about online teaching and learning? That's the general question. And the two particular questions we're asking you is the experience less personal? So could you put, that's question one, yes or no in the chat. Is the experience less personal now than before the pandemic?
So we've got...
put your gut feeling. would you say it's less personal? You put yes. If you disagree, you think it's more personal or the same, you could put no.
So let's see what the audience is saying. So okay. We're getting...
And then the second question is slightly more, let's say, has greater implications, perhaps. It's a slightly broader question. Is because of all this online teaching in Zoom and so on, would you say we are losing the human touch? Yes or no? Are we losing the human touch? Okay. So Yuri, could you give us just a general impression from...
Absolutely, Ben. So what we're getting at, I'd say mostly no's and yeses for the first one. So it was like half and half, but okay, a lot good. Of yeses for the second question.
Sorry, say that again, Yuri.
We've got
yeses.
And a lot of yeses for the second one, for your
really?
Second question. But there are some okay. no's as well. But yeah, we're getting loads of answers. So
okay, well, see, in that case, that's very well. That's, thank you very much, Yuri, for your
no problem.
That's very interesting. I think, Ceri, you'd agree that we hope that in that case that, well, I'm glad in a way, because I think this talk will be especially relevant. Clearly, this is something we don't want to happen, to lose the human touch. So really, this is, if some of you are thinking that, then perhaps our talk today could persuade you that it's not the case. So I'm going to begin with a testimony from a teacher who I met recently in Brazil. We were in a workshop talking actually about this very subject, online learning and teaching and the pandemic. And he was full of his testimony was full of personal reflections about what happened in the classroom. But I'm going to show you the part of the talk now, where part of the interview now, where he gives a general impression. So you'll see that he indirectly he answers those two questions that I just asked you.
And I think that now that we're teaching online, we're finding that all of these skills that good teachers had in the face-to-face environment, they're transferable to the online environment. And I think the teachers who already did a good job with that, with connecting with students and being personal and having this, this ability to connect really with people in general, I think they were able to transfer that to the online environment. I don't mean that it was easy. I don't think it was. It wasn't easy for me. But I think once we did that collectively, once we learned that it was possible to connect and be personal online, then I think we found something very special to explore. That is this experience of I can teach anywhere, anytime, and still do a good job and still make an impact on my students' lives.
Okay. I think a very eloquent, articulate testimony there. Let's have a look at that. And I think what's interesting about what he's saying here is that it clearly was a process. It wasn't something all of us, when we were teaching the pandemic, were thrown in at the deep end. In some ways, it was rather than online learning, it was remote learning and teaching, wasn't it? That we're kind of teaching, experimenting, improvising, and adapting our work that we were so used to doing face-to-face to the online environment. But what I think is interesting is that he says that, you know, once we learned it was possible to retain those kind of personal connections that you made face-to-face, online as well, then we found something special to explore. And I think that what he's saying there in a way is that in actual fact, his answer to the question, are we losing the human touch? I would say he's almost saying, no, we're actually gaining in a way, because there is this kind of conception that, you know, doing all of this through Zoom or any online platform means you're going to somehow, it's going to become less personal, less human. And he's actually saying that, no, it's actually very special because as we can do this anywhere, anytime, and still do a good job and make an impact on our lives. There's this kind of surprise, I think, element here that is very clear from his testimony, that this transference of skills was possible and not just was possible, but actually could, he's suggesting, I think, that it actually enhanced his relationship with his students and the connections with his students. Anyway, that's one testimony. Here, this is a kind of summing up now of some of the positive and negative implications of the pandemic on our teaching and learning. Obviously, not everything was, you know, as Juan stated, and I'm sure your situation, wherever you're teaching, may have been very different. So let's, I think it's good just to sum these up. Like Juan, some teachers have forged stronger connections with their students, and that is clear. And I think this is often the case with adult teachers teaching in the adult segment. An increased empathy and awareness of both learners and teachers as people is another positive consequence of the pandemic and more online teaching and learning, and a greater sense of community and collaboration among teachers as well. So when we're talking about the personal touch, also we're also talking about not just the relationship between teachers and students, but between teachers and teachers, greater collaboration and a greater awareness of well-being and resilience. And I'm sure in this Cambridge Live, these 4 days of talks, there will be a number of other presentations on these topics. But of course, we have to be realistic, and there have been negative implications as well, negative consequences. And I think that probably the biggest one is this, that the digital divide has become an educational divide, and having a reliable internet connection is now very, 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 it's fundamental. If you don't have it, then you are left out, you are excluded. And when we're talking about inclusivity these days, then this is a very, very important issue to bear in mind. Clearly, many are excluded because of this, what is it, essentially a financial or technical issue. Flexibility is expected, but can be exploitative and upset your life and work balance. So clearly, anytime learning, anytime teaching is kind of wonderful in many ways, but of course it means that we, our routine is upset, and this can have negative consequences. And it obviously, Juan, I know, well, he was talking about his experience teaching young adults and adults, and clearly with other students, often with teenagers, it's not so easy to do that. And we're aware of that. And we've all been in classrooms where students have their cameras off and not visible, and then as a result, there's a greater teacher talking time. And it's also, I think, pretty obvious that some teachers have found it more difficult to feedback and to monitor online. But I'll give you, just to finish this first part of the presentation, here's one more positive testimony from Lucy Crichton from the Secret Garden English School. So this time from a school I visited, and she is focusing here on young learners. We wanted to give you a testimony from someone teaching adults and then someone teaching primary and secondary. And again, I think her testimony echoes a little bit what Juan was talking about, which is this idea that this kind of surprise that the kind of methodology or the skills, the personal connections, all of these things that were that developed in the face-to-face classroom, she's saying here, are still pertinent now. And I think I think you'd agree, no, Ceri, that that is something that you get again and again when you ask teachers about feedback about the pandemic and the consequences it's had on their teaching, that there's this kind of pleasant, well, surprise that, good teaching methodology is good teaching methodology, and forging personal connections and all of these things is possible, and there may be pluses as well. And I love what she says here about the practical living side of the language that the students love, the group work and the problem solving and the analyzing. I think she's saying there that those are the things that were even enhanced in online. So, Ceri, I think you're going to take over now.
Okay, so let's take a slightly more academic look at what Ben's been talking about already, and share with you some findings from a paper which was written very early on in that movement to the emergency remote learning that was happening online as much as possible, with teachers trying to find the best way to be able to connect with their students, even though we were all locked away in our own homes. So this paper is a review of hundreds of studies into online learning and what factors boost success in online learning. But they were looking at studies pre-pandemic. So this was online learning across a whole range of different subjects, including language. And this is what they came up with as the list of top five factors in success in any form of online learning. So teaching quality is more important than how lessons are delivered. This is the number one message. And this was coming out in our teacher testimonies as well. But here we can see that the research also backs this up. So whatever the teachers, whatever the students, sorry, whatever the learners are learning online, with or without a physical presence of a teacher, the digital presence of a teacher is still incredibly important. So we can see as well, of course, these are all things that Ben has touched on. Technology, access to technology, obviously this is a factor which we can't ignore. But moving on, we come back to people again. Peer interactions are also a key part of motivation and engagement online, so that you don't feel that it's you and a machine and you're alone. The personal touch is really important. And students who are working on their own, and a lot of digital online learning is to do with independent study. So the Anytime, Anywhere plus of online and digital learning is that you can choose your pace, your place, when and how you do it. But the report suggests that students still need support. And where does that support come? That support comes from a teacher. So they, motivation, engagement is always boosted by the presence of a teacher, by the personal touch from the teacher. And the last factor, I think, that is something that, again, we all know, but it's wonderful to remember it, that diversity also in the way that we present materials, in the way that we get students to interact with materials, different approaches at different moments will appeal to different learners. And this is something that we need to build in. And one of those approaches, which we can see from the rest of the factors, which is possibly the number one most important, is the personal touch. So Ben, we can highlight this on the next slide. So here we are. Number one, it's you, the teacher. It's us, the teachers, or the materials writers, making sure that teaching quality is part of the course, but making sure that the space for the teacher is always there, no matter what the course. Is it online? Is it offline? Is it face-to-face? Is it blended? Whatever the course, the human touch is the important thing. Ben, thanks. Okay, so let's have a look also at this more detailed quote. Just take a second or two to read through it. And again, this is what both Joanne and Lucy were saying, that the skills are transferable. Quality of teaching is the important thing, and it's the same. The same factors are important. Scaffolding, feedback, being there, making sure that the learners feel that someone is supporting them, someone is interacting with them, someone is tracking their progress and celebrating their progress, so that they move on and feel motivated to continue in their studies. So whether that's real time or whether that's asynchronous, all of these factors are important. And the number one is still the personal touch. Okay, now we're going to move on to this interesting concept of the physical and the digital and the interaction between them. I think one of the things that we all saw personally and learnt during our lockdowns, which took different forms in different countries, but basically we started to interact so much more with people who were in personal physical spaces and sharing this more formal online space. So basically we were in classrooms, but we were also at home. So the digital space and the physical space, the physical context where we were learning, there was a slight mismatch. Suddenly you were in your classroom almost in your pajamas, as it were. One of those recurring nightmares, anxiety nightmares, if you turn up into a public in a public place and you're not dressed correctly. But what I think what happened, and what Duane said in another part of his interview that we didn't see today, but was that this actually broke down barriers. We suddenly became very, very intensely aware of everybody being in a personal space as well as a shared space. I think this is what we're talking about when we talk about exploring the physical context and the digital spaces working together. Okay, so this idea that no matter how you are learning or how you are teaching, whether it's online or face-to-face, there is a physical context. We are physical beings. We exist as a body. We feel, we hear, we see. So maybe in my space, for example, just now, a truck has driven by in the road, and that could have been a minor distraction for me that you know nothing about. And this was something that we were dealing with as teachers, was that each one of our students was in a slightly different physical space. And we needed to be able to understand a little bit more about the physical space where our students were, on two levels. One, to know what distractions were there. Maybe there were obstacles, maybe there were problems, maybe there were physical discomforts. Was it too hot? Was it too cold? Is there noise going on in the background? So just being aware, first of all, of what the physical context is, but also positively to be able to use these physical contexts as part of our learning equipment, part of our teaching tools in the lesson. So we need to take this into account. And I think during the pandemic, we were super, super sensitive to this, to where people were working. Were they in their bedroom? Were they sharing a kitchen table? I worked with someone whose office was in the cupboard under the stairs. It was, you know, and it just, I think all of this, the realization of everybody's different physical contexts, just had a lot more empathy. Okay, so how can we make our online classrooms physical? So first of all, interact with your students' physical space. So it's to get your students to include the physical in their lesson, not only the screen, which is in, we tend to do this, we're in front of the screen, there's that much of us on show, but what about what's around us? So you can see here, I'm on a balcony, I have some plants, I have a painting that my daughter painted, etc. I can take you into my world, and I will do this with my students too, and interact not only with the face on the screen, but everything that's around. So also, it's a great opportunity to bring in things that we have around us as well. Actually touch something, bring a physical object, bring it to the camera. So for example, okay, it is morning here in Spain. So I have my British upbringing means I have a cup of tea next to me as we're speaking. Oh no, poor Ben. Okay, so suffering with your throat. Yeah. So this is such a simple thing, but it can be used in so many ways. We'll have a quick look at that on the next slide as well. But let's look at tip three first. Incorporate movement. So another problem of being in front of the screen is we tend to forget. It's all ears and mouth and eyes, but what about the rest of our body? So the idea of incorporating movement into the lesson as well, actually getting up and moving around and being physical in an online class is actually possible and incredibly motivating to break up this sedentary, almost two-dimensional relationship that can be the relationship that we have with the screen can become three-dimensional. It's really important to remember the dimensions. So let's have a quick look at some tasks that we can use. The show and tell. I could tell you a lot more about my mug, which is about 25 years old. It's amazing how long this mug has lasted and been through dishwashers and microwaves and around the world with me. So I can tell you the story through an object. Listen. Now, this is a great kind of taking people inside themselves but outside at the same time, is to ask your students to just be silent for, it doesn't have to be long, it can be 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 30 seconds. We're going to try it for just five might not be enough, but what you need to do is listen to the sounds that are around you and pick out as many different sounds as you can in 5 seconds. So I'm going to take my headphones off and just listen for 5 seconds. Okay, so 5 seconds gave me the chance to hear a member of the household doing something in the background, a little kind of a shuffling, but very, very respectfully. I'm so sorry, but I do have to confess to this. I can hear the sea. I can actually hear the sea from the painting on at the moment. So, and I heard a couple of cars driving by. But this already gives you a setting. I'm at home. I live near the sea. There's also a busy road. So students listen and then share the sounds that they've heard. This can be very, very powerful. The longer they listen for, the more sounds they'll hear, because initially we just hear the superficial and then we start to listen more and we hear more and more sounds that we've never noticed before. And task three, this is the movement. So I'm not going to ask you to do this task and I'm not going to do it myself, but I'd like you to imagine the task. So we're going to do imagined embodiment rather than real embodiment. But one of my favorites as a warmer kind of movement activity with a new class would be to ask them to look around and find the nearest door. Okay, so where is the nearest door to where you are sitting at the moment? So I'm going to ask you to just do that. Look around. Can you see the nearest door? And now I'd like you to make a calculation, which is how many steps would it take you to get to your door? Now, in a class, I would normally ask students to get up. Oh, first of all, sorry, they make a prediction. How many steps they think. They get up, they walk to the door, they count the steps, they come back and they report on how many steps it took. Now, it's an incredibly simple task. You can do it with all ages, all levels, but it's not the task in itself. It's the getting up, the personal touch that everybody's door is going to be slightly different, closer, further away. So I'll ask, whose door was the furthest away? Who had to walk the furthest to get to their door? There's always that danger that you think, oh my goodness, they'll get up, they'll walk away, they'll never come back again. I've lost my students. But this can be very, very engaging to get students to actually leave their computer, do something, come back and report on it. I saw one primary school teacher doing it with her primary maths students, and she asked them to go to the kitchen, to open the fridge and count the number of eggs. It was very simple. She didn't want them to bring the eggs back. She said, do not touch the eggs. Leave the eggs where they are. They came back, and with the numbers that all of the students typed into their chat box or raised a hand and showed how many eggs they had, they used that for a number of different maths problems. So, but the students got up, they walked into their own world, they brought information back from their world, and they shared it. Okay,
so I know, I was going to say my fridge is just here, literally behind me. That doesn't seem like it. So I could tell you how many eggs I've got.
So should we look
these
quickly?
These are just the bullet points. Yeah.
Just a quick summary. So how do these types of tasks support the personal touch? First of all, we boost awareness of learners as individuals and that they work in different spaces. We also validate the diversity of the contexts, and everybody in the class is aware of the diversity, and this really helps to boost empathy across the whole of the class. And everyone's answer is important because everyone's answer is personal and different. Thank you, Ben.
Great, thanks very much. So with those practical ideas, I think we can see that some of those testimonies that I was talking about at the beginning, how that they can kind of, practical applications of that, and the way that human connections can be forged through the physical. And I think what Ceri said about the two-dimensional space becoming three-dimensional is so important. As she said, we focus so much just on the face of the camera and ignore the background, ignore everything that's surrounding us. And that's, of course, maybe what Juan was suggesting when he said that this anytime learning, anywhere learning, can in some ways enhance what we do because of these surprising elements. We're not all sitting in the classroom like we used to be doing, and that in itself is interesting. But how do you, those are some practical tasks that any of you can do at home, and but how do we, incorporate the personal touch into some material? Ceri and I have been working on Evolve Digital over the last few years. This is a truly blended course with self-access materials for independent learning and regular synchronous lessons with the teacher. So when Ceri was talking about the teacher's support there, that many adult learners in particular, because this is for young adults and adults, feel having worked online, having worked independently during the pandemic, they feel they can do it all themselves. And although there are courses which are purely self-access, it would be, I think most of us would agree that these are not successful learning tools, that the students need some kind of support, feedback from teachers. How do we incorporate that into the online element? So this course is different because it incorporates an online element, independent learning, asynchronous with synchronous. But I'm going to focus particularly on the independent learning side, this asynchronous part, to show you how we can incorporate the personal touch in an environment which seems impersonal. So one way of doing that is with real teachers. So when the students go into their classrooms, their asynchronous class, remember this is self-study, they have a teacher who introduces each unit and greets them. Let's just have a little look at just a little part of Isabella, who is welcoming students to Unit 2.
Welcome back. It's great to see you again. Are you ready for some more learning? So let's get Unit 2 going. So much stuff. That's the name of the unit. Do you have too much stuff? No. I'm sure. Most of us have some stuff that we don't really need, or we don't need anymore. It can be hard to throw things away. Why do you think that is? In Lesson 1, we'll talk about things we've had for a while. We'll learn some new words to talk about possessions, and we'll figure out how to use the present perfect with ever, never, or, and since. In Lesson 2, we're going to talk about things you own. What's your favorite possession? For most people these days, it's their phone. My phone has my whole life in it.
So can you see, I think that's a very nice example. It's a very personal touch there. She's not just talking about the objectives of the lesson. She's talking about her own experience, about her phone, how important it is for her. And I was just noticing the things she has in her, having listened to what Ceri was saying about her room, look at the space she's in, the things that she has in her room as well. Again, this is forging a kind of personal connection there. She's clearly in her house as well. So this gives it a more personal, more human touch. And in this asynchronous element, which I was talking about of Evolve Digital, Yes, the students do work through independently. They have that introduction from the teacher at the beginning to greet them. But the important thing to remember is that they have an incredible amount of support. So when they do the speaking, they have a final speaking task at the end of each lesson, and they have a final writing task. They then send, they have models there. So there you can clearly see a model. In this particular case, it is talking about experiences. Which have you done? Talk about at least four experiences. Gives you, obviously they've been looking at the relevant grammar and vocabulary for the speaking task, but notice the model there, which I think they can listen to that and they can read it, and that gives them a lot of support. And of course, then they send it to a real teacher who then provides them with feedback, keeps them going, keeps their motivation going. So this is how we have made this asynchronous material, this independent learning material, more personal and more human. For your interest, of course, this is another speaking task in the synchronous part, in the students, the idea of it is a kind of flipped approach where the students do the independent, do the asynchronous task material first, then once they've done the asynchronous material, they go to the synchronous, they go to the face-to-face class, whether that's face-to-face or on Zoom, it's live, it's synchronous. Then the teacher, then these classes are all based on speaking. And these are often included extended speaking tasks like this one. So what makes Evolve Digital personal? Well, as I said, there's synchronous lessons with a real teacher. That's the example I just showed you. It's a PowerPoint slide. In fact, teachers have these speaking lessons on PowerPoint with teacher support to use either in the face-to-face classroom or in a platform like Zoom. And as I said as well, there's speaking and writing tasks from the asynchronous, and this provides a bridge between the two parts. So that it's a kind of the personal touch in two different ways there. And there are asynchronous lessons with a teacher guide. This teacher changes from one level to the others. But that's not the only thing. There are also other aspects to Evolve Digital. There are voices, faces, stories, people throughout the material, video material, documentaries, dramas. Here are a couple of examples from some of the units looking at different aspects of American culture, for example, and Vox Pops, again, many non-native speakers from New York in this particular case. So the material is full of these real people as well, which act as models and support for our learners. Ceri.
Yeah, thanks, Ben. So keeping on the theme of real voices, real faces, real people in the course, let's take a closer look at this cast of characters, of language learners that are also an important part of the course, the real students and the expert speakers. So for the lower levels of the course, there are videos throughout the material of real students, so students who are learning English, who answer the questions that the students are also answering. So they act as either a model, or if we think of it as a task cycle, the students do the task, they listen to the real speaker, they compare their answers, but these are faces that come up again and again, and so they become familiar. Let's take a closer look. Okay, so here is a cast of real students, and you can see that they come from a number of different countries, a number of different language backgrounds, and they feature throughout the student's book, whether you're working with a print version of the book or you're working with a digital version of the course, these real students are there to give an idea of peer interaction even when the students are working on asynchronous material. So let's take an example of how this would work. We have a unit on food, and one of the one of the readings is about a famous soup, chicken soup. And most cultures have a variation on chicken soup. And the question that the students are going to talk about is food in their own country. And they can either talk about their food first and then listen to Alessandra, who is our real student in this unit, or they can listen to Alessandra first and then they can talk about their own food. So let's just listen to Alessandra introducing herself.
From Brazil, Brazil.
Okay, so obviously she then goes on to talk about one of her favorite Brazilian dishes, but I'm sorry we don't have time to listen to Alessandra's complete explanation. So then at the higher levels, we have the expert speakers. We're moving on from the real students who psychologically are a great boost to the confidence of lower level students, because what they see is someone who's a language learner who's maybe like a step or two ahead of them, but it gives them a realistic target of, I can do that too, I can be that person. Success can be measured against another learner. In the case of the advanced students, we look at people who are, they're all living in New York, actually, this cast of expert speakers, but they come from different countries, different backgrounds. They're working in different jobs. What they have in common is that they are all highly successful, highly competent users of English. And this is what comes through. So this now is the motivation. You're an advanced student, you're pushing yourself. This is your goal. You see the real speaker as what you're aiming for. So let's listen to Ryoko answering this question, just the first part of the question.
Okay, for driving, I don't really feel comfortable. High school students, 15-year-olds driving around. Maybe it has something to do with me being a mother and living in New York City and looking at crazy traffic all the time.
Okay,
thank you. So we see this like really personal side of our speakers as well. The personal touch is still there. There she is, the mother in New York, answering the question. Okay, thanks, Ben.
Thank you, Ceri. So just got 2 or 3 minutes left. So quickly want to wrap up. What have we learned about online teaching and learning in this session? Well, at the very beginning, we asked you whether we were losing the human touch, whether our online learning and teaching have become more or become less personal. Well, we hope that in this, for those of you who said it is less personal and we are losing the human touch, we hope that we have suggested to you that may not be the case, that digital online learning can be made personal, that it can, that focusing on the physical context, for example, that remembering that you and your teaching methodology and your presence and your support is the important thing and not the tech itself. We hope we've given you some tips, some suggestions for doing that with practical tasks. And we hope as well that you've been able to see different teacher testimonies, which also support that these ideas. Here are a few more conclusions. Remembering what Juan said, what Lucy was saying, we can still teach as we've always taught, that good sound teaching methodology is sound teaching methodology, whatever the mode of delivery, whatever the format you're using. And this, I think, is very empowering. It's a very empowering message, but I think it's one that, again, as I said at the beginning, is one that we can often ignore when we're surrounded by these screens and everything seems to be inhuman. The personal touch will always engage and motivate. And we hoped as well that we've shown you in our materials as well, Evolve Digital, how that is also possible. And the key to successful learning, online or not, is always going to be the presence of the teacher and their quality of their teaching. So just to finish, those are kind of the key points we want you to take away this morning. But I'm going to finish with one quotation from a teacher in Hungary, Cela Pesti. She has a lovely way of sort of summing up her experience of teaching in the pandemic. She she refers to this as sharing is caring. She says, I'll read it to you as we have just a few seconds left. Looking back at these few months and all the challenges and new practices I wanted or had to implement, I can identify one single phrase that strongly resonates with this whole period. Sharing is caring. The sharing attitude of my colleagues and students became the driving force for me. All these gestures of sharing facilitated the learning of my students, my colleagues, and myself, and ensured the humanity of the otherwise impersonal environment of online education. I think that's a very eloquent way to sum up some of the points we've been trying to make this morning. Hope you've enjoyed the talk, and I hope you enjoy this Cambridge Live, these 4 days of talks that you have ahead of you. Well, that's goodbye from me. And
goodbye from me.
enjoy the rest of the sessions. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks, Ben and Ceri, for that great session. I'm also keeping it physical.
Good.
And we have some questions from the Q&A. What about students with special needs? How can their individual needs be adapted to online teaching?
Okay, Ceri, which would you like to? And because for special needs, there's a very big area. I don't know.
It's a huge area. Obviously, we can use digital tools to help most students access. We can use text instead of images if we have people who have problems, even technically accessing images, because also there's a connectivity and a data problem there. We can use audio instead of images as well. If there's some kind of problem with reading text on a screen, or we can reverse that and we can have text instead of audio when there are problems with actually hearing or listening to the audio. So technology has already given us an incredible amount of support for that. But really, in the end, helping students with special needs is all about understanding those needs, being sympathetic and proactive in finding solutions for those needs, and working very often. And this is where the hard work comes in for teachers who are working with special needs students within their mainstream classroom, is we just need to take the time to find out exactly how we can work with those needs. So we always can, but really, yes, there is a difference between the digital classroom and the face-to-face classroom, because actually the digital classroom gives us more tools, more ways to actually reach that student individually. Even a silly little thing, or it seems like a silly little thing, is the private chat tool in a classroom, where a student who needs more support can be given a support privately, quietly, by the teacher through the private chat, or that student can ask for more help, more support privately without the whole class seeing that they're being given special or individual attention. So I think a very brief, superficial answer to a huge question, but yeah, definitely there's so much we can do.
Yeah, I think you're right that in some ways it's easier now with these tools that we have to address. Obviously, it depends on the needs. But then I was going to say frameworks like the Universal Design for Learning is another interesting. I don't know if you is watching know about this, but this is kind of the idea that when you're presenting material, think about presenting that material in diverse ways, whether that's audio, whether that's video, whether that's text, so that different learners can access it in their preferred in the way that they prefer, or the way that they need to access it. So I think there's a combination of things. I think those tools that Ceri was referring to are very, very important and actually make it easier for us. But there are also frameworks that you can look to. The Universal Design for Learning, UDL, as sometimes referred to, is a very good place to go. If you want to Google that, you'll find some interesting ideas.
Thanks, Ben and Ceri, for these answers. Sarah is asking, how could we apply the movement for adults? It may seem a bit funny or useless for them moving around for tasks.
Okay, I'm going to start again, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
The little task that I told you about, the count the steps to go to your to the nearest door, I've exclusively used that with adults, and it works beautifully. Adults almost need the movement more than young learners. We build in movement into young learners' classes anyway. But with adults, maybe we let them sit for too long. So there are, for example, recently a teacher was telling me about her lesson where she'd asked her adult students to look for something that was broken in the house, a small item, it could be anything, and just bring it back to the camera. And then they had to talk about what it was, how it got broken, were they going to fix it, were they not going to fix it. So the movement was actually just getting up, going away from the screen, finding an object and bringing it back. It might seem like minimal movement, but it's movement. There is movement involved in that. Even simply, if you're sitting through an hour-long lesson, that's too long to be sitting down. You shouldn't be sitting for more than 30 minutes without doing something physical. So at the 30-minute point, even if it's simply get up, stretch, turn around, walk to the nearest window, do something that's physical. And of course, then you can incorporate that into your lesson. But moving is important. It shakes things up. It wakes us up. It makes sure that we're not getting tied into that two-dimensionality. So yes, movement with adults, absolutely.
Yeah, and in the same way that we need to move in the face-to-face classroom. And, you know, we're not saying we're going to do mingles all the time, but you can't, if it's not moving, changing the classroom management, moving from pair work to group work, individual work, quiet work, somehow changing the environment in which learners are learning is very important. But it's much more, it seems to be more difficult to do that when it's online. And so I think any ideas like this, where you're getting some kind of physical response is very important and enhancing what we said about making this two-dimensional space or seemingly inhuman space a more personal, more human one. I think it helps immensely. But I understand the question about thinking that perhaps adults would resist to it, but it's just a question of getting them, I think, thinking of the benefits of it, that it's kind of an excuse. And in fact, they can just bring in fascinating, surprising elements into the classroom that you wouldn't have imagined, but they can only do that because you've asked them to get away from just looking at the camera for 100% of the time.